part in the browser. And the application I'm going to make today is based on Peepcode screencasts. This is a really cool website that has a bunch of professionally produced hour and a half long screencasts. And I've watched a lot of these, but I always forget which ones I've seen. So I want to make an application that lets me track which ones I've watched. And so this is actually what it's going to end up looking like. It has a list of all the videos that you can watch, and when you click on one, it marks it as watched and saves it to a database, so when you come back, it's still the same. And to do this, I'm going to use a gem I created that you can use at home. Gem install peepcode, the peepcode gem I made. So the first thing I'm going to do is generate a new Rails application. I'm going to call it video tracker. And then, oops. I want to install my peepcode gem so we can see what it does. The peepcode gem basically goes to this page and scrapes information off of it and returns some JSON. So to install gems, you add them to your gem file and then run bundle or bundle install. And that will install the gems for you. While it's doing that, I'm going to start up the Rails server just to see what we have right out of the box on a new Rails application. Usually there's a welcome to Rails page. Yeah, 3005. Okay, well, that doesn't matter. We actually are going to want to get rid of that. So that page is public index, and we want to make a new default page. So I'm going to set our root route. To the welcome controller. Index page is kind of just a convention of Rails. And then I'm going to create that controller with that controller action. Okay, I'm just baffled. Not displaying anything. Okay, well, while it's not working, I want to show you how the peepcode gem is going to work. Start the Rails console, and that will give us access to the whole Rails environment. And the peepcode gem gives us this class screencasts, which returns a bunch of JSON data. And you can look at one of them. We've got title, a link to the image, and a link to the actual screencast. So this is the data we're going to be using in our application. And what I want to do is import this data into a database. Because right now it's just it's in this gem, but it's not in our database. And I'm going to create a database table called video. And it's going to have the same attributes, title, image, link. And I also want to be able to say whether or not I've already watched it. I'm going to create a column watched, and that's a Boolean, which accepts only true or false values. This Rails G model will create a model class and a database, a migration to create a database table. You can see it created a migration to add a table to our database, and it created a model for us. I'm going to migrate the database. Okay, so now we have this, we have videos. I want to import all of our videos. I'm going to make a rake task to do this. And this requires the Rails environment, so I get access to all of my classes in the Peepcode gym. Then I can get all the screencasts from Peepcode. And for each of them, I want to create a new video. And so that should create a bunch of videos. See if that works. No. Okay. Now if we go back to our console, you probably see that there are now 82 videos in our database. So, yay for that. Now, one problem we have is if I were to run rake import again, it would bring in another 82 videos, and we would have duplications. So what I want to do is make sure that we don't allow duplications in our database. And how I'm going to do that is use a test-driven approach. Thanks for Noah for helping me figure this out. Here at CV, we've decided to use RSpec as our testing framework. So to install RSpec, we add it to our gem file and install it. So now I'm going to write a new test for our model. And all of our tests require this spec helper, and then in our spec we have blocks that say describe, and then basically specify how the behavior of how our application is going to work, or how the object is going to work. Okay, so I don't want it to allow duplicates. What I'm going to do is create a video. And then create another video with the same link. And basically, I want to assert that the number of videos is 1, even though I tried to create 2, because the database or active record prevents us from creating a duplicate record. I'll run our code to prevent duplications in our database. And there we go. One failure. We got, we expected one. We got two. So now I'm going to go into my the class for a video. And add this method, which tells Ruby, this is Ruby preventing us from creating and saving a record that has the same link as another record. So if I run the test again, it should pass.
So every time you run a test, it doesn't go back to the
database. That's right. It creates a test database. It spins up a separate environment and loads in a new database.
Yeah, you can do tricks like that with the fire
So now that we have our database and preventing duplicates, I'm going to go ahead and move on to accessing this data over the web. Because we need to get this data into our application somehow. And that's going to be done in a controller. So I'm gonna create a new file called BS controller. Oops. And all Rails controllers inherit from application controller. And this controller is only going to respond to requests for JSON. And I want an action that allows me to get all of the videos in JSON form. So this should, whenever we call this action, videos controller index action, we'll fetch all our videos from the database and render them in JSON format. No, this this is new in Rails 3.1, I think. These are responders. Right. So theoretically, now I could hit this up. Maybe not funny. Start the server first. And this is right here is our URL for our application, and then this videos controller. So that's what we want to see. Unfortunately, we get the code for the error page because we haven't defined a route to this yet. And this, so I'm going to add the resources videos, which gives us basic access all these methods on the videos resource. And it'll call back into our controller code looking for methods. So then when we run curl, we get our big list of JSON. Sure. Curl is a way to send an HTTP request just from your command line. You can send git, post, put, delete, all the methods from the command line. So I'm basically simulating how our front-end app is going to be interacting with the server. Front-end app is going to be sending HTTP requests to these same resources.
So if you expand the idea of typing an address in the browser, you're going to get that same response.
curl. curl does the same thing as just visiting this URL in the browser. So you can see this is the same exact JSON that we received on our curl. The next resource that I want to be able to access is just one video at a time. So we would be doing something like like that, where we specify the ID of the video. We get another error there because we haven't implemented that action in our controller yet. So the show method is the standard resource action for showing one record. The UR will pass in this parameter ID, which we use to get our video, and respond with it. So now we should be able to get just one at a time. So if we look at our app that we want to make, we now have the ability to fetch a list of all of the videos using our index action, but we still need to be able to update whether we've watched it or not. When I click on one of these, I am indicating yes, I've now watched it. If you can tell, red means unwatched, green means watched, and that's stored in the database, so whenever you come back, it's still there. Now, in order to update records, the standard action is update. Pretty simple. So with update, what we want to do is grab our video again using the same strategy as for show. And then we want to call update attributes. And we're only wanting to update the watched attribute. And we're going to expect a parameter passed in called watched. Okay. Update attributes is going to set the value of watched and then call save to save in the database. We also only want to allow certain values for this. So this is, if you remember, watched is a Boolean. So we only want to accept true or false.
What was a Boolean again?
Boolean means true or false. Okay, so on this line, we're saying if our parameters are true or false, we'll update. If not, if we send in some random thing like the word hedgehogs or something, nothing will happen here.
Yeah, I like the extra technique that you're using there. It's in a way you can see, gets like an elaborate if-else statement in one line, but really you can just elaborate. You just enumerate all possibilities in that same array and just go down and through to that range.
Oh.
Is
that like the columns
and
Boolean
one and zero are both true, I think. Well, active record is what's doing it. So, I'm not doing this to enforce database constraints, but if someone passes in something else, I want to render nothing with a status of 304, something like that, so that we can tell the user that they've requested a resource and try to do something with it that is not allowed. So we didn't modify it, we're just returning back to them nothing.
There was another point real quick.
Yeah.
So actually, active record is actually hard to take care of the type checking as well.
next thing I want to do is test whether I can update the watched column, true or false. And to do that, I'm going to use the HTTP method put, which maps to the update action here. And if I run curl on this resource for the second video, this is using git, and you notice it returns watch is null. And this is the notation for specifying the method and then specifying the data that you want to pass in as parameters. Remember, our controller action is requiring a watched parameter. Right here. And then I'll give if you look at our server, we received this put request. We loaded in the video. We updated the watched. We set it to true, and then we saved it.
Oh, that's like,
right.
Right.
So now, if you look at it here, we have watched is true. So. Building the back end section of this, we can get a list of all of our videos, one of them, and update the watched column. So now we want to move into implementing this using all AJAX calls and introduce backbone.js. Now, when I make applications, I want to make them responsive as possible, so you can use them on the iPhone or the iPad or whatever format you like. So I use Twitter Bootstrap.
That's what Twitter Bootstrap does? I've seen that several times.
Twitter Bootstrap, yeah, it's like the designer.
We actually use Twitter Bootstrap in auto.com to make the so we add in Bootstrap, and then Bootstrap is just the wrapper of a MediaQuery. Yeah, exactly. And then I'm going to generate a Twitter Bootstrap layout for our web page. I'm pretty sure this is the right command. We want fixed. I need to restart my server now. We brought in those new gems and style sheets. Okay, so this is the basic Twitter Bootstrap you're gonna see when you create a new project. It's nice and responsive, and what we're looking at is editing the content in this section. So for now, let's just forget about all these sidebar things. When I made our welcome controller, it generated for us this file that you see here, what we see on our application. And we want to replace this with the title and then we're going to have a list and a global wrapper for this whole thing. And that's all the HTML I'm going to write for this app. And now we see our title, and we're going to use JavaScript to fill in the contents of this screencasts list. And we're going to use this welcome JavaScript, except I want to move it. I don't want to use CoffeeScript, just plain old JavaScript. And then the next thing I want to do is install Backbone.js for handling our Ajax and rendering of our views. And luckily, you can do that manually. It's pretty easy, but there's also a really nice gem for it. I think $ means last file. Now install my gem and then what this is going to do is install the Backbone JavaScript library. It's going to install the underscore JavaScript library and I think also the JSON2 library. We're going to have to restart our server. We were using the Safari. Did I install Backbone? There we go. So now we have Backbone installed, and I hadn't refreshed the browser yet. I just need a refresh. So I don't like Safari's developer things very much, but the Chrome's not working right. Chrome's is the best. Like Firebug's nice, but Chrome is way better. Except it doesn't work right now. So. So I'm gonna do everything in our welcome JavaScript and make sure we load jQuery before we do anything. This is kind of standard. There's other ways to do this, but we make sure that the whole document's ready. And then in Backbone, we're going to use Backbone to fetch our JSON into model on the client side. No, I don't need any Ruby in this. So, first thing we'll do is create a model screencast. And we're going to extend this from a plain Backbone model. And that gives us a couple special features that we'll see in a little bit. Like, I'm gonna create a new screencast to show you how it works. In Backbone with models, you can set the URL for a resource, and then once you've set the URL, you can call fetch. And what fetch does is fetches it, grabs the JSON from it, and populates the object with that JSON. What this is going to do is make a new screencast object, get its JSON, and then log it to the console. What? virtual host. Okay, Chrome is just not working. Okay, well we can still use this. So here it's logging that. I got the console to work in Chrome. This is the object that told it to log. It's actually pulled in this data on screencast number 2. So now we have this JavaScript object that we can do things to. We can call git to get its title. There you go. Design bundle. That's the first or the second one. Now that we've got the concept of how one model works. I'm going to introduce Backbone Collection. So Collection does, I think, extends from model itself, but also introduces some new things. Okay, so we'll do the same thing. Create a new collection of screencasts, and then give it the URL of all of our videos. So what this is going to do is fetch all of the screencasts from the server and log them. So here we go. This is our collection object. And it has all of our models. It created a new model for every screencast object. All these models have attributes. What I actually forgot to do is pass in the type of model that this wants. So we see models are all Backbone model. If I refresh, they should all be screencast objects now. All right, these are screencast objects now. Okay, so what, you say? How are we going to get this? How are we going to get this on the page and turn into markup? Well, so far we've been using Backbone objects for the data, and we're also using Backbone objects to create DOM elements. And we'll do that with a Backbone view object.
What for?
It is just declaring a new variable.
Okay.
Oh, wow. What? Did I do something horrible? Okay, So, with the view, we're going to give it a property called tag name, and it's going to be a li object. So, we have on our page a ul tag, an unordered list, and into it we're going to insert a big list of screencast views, which are all list items. And we want to teach it how to render itself into the page. So we're going to screencast view, and its element is going to be this list item. So whenever I render, it's going to create a list item, and then set its text to a screencast. So what I'm going to do when I fetch this one model is say, declare a new view and pass in this model. And then alright, you see that we're rendering that view and appending it on there. Now, but we don't want to do this for just one. We want to do it for all of these, right? All these screencasts. So we're going to use the underscore library. And for each of these models, we're going to create a new screencast view and render it to the page. Hey, whoa. Okay, I'm rendering it to both UL elements, but we just wanted to do the screencast one. Or is that the name of it? Here's our markup. Oh, it's class. There we go, a screencast. But we actually wanted to display the real name. So I'm going to go back to our render function and teach it how to do that. So instead of text a screencast, I wanted to do text this.model.get. Title. And because we pass in a model right here into our new screencast view, we get access to this.model. And that model has a title. So now we've got all of them rendering in there like that. Real quickly, I'm going to go and demonstrate how to style this. I'm going to make the default color of these red. That's a little better. Maybe okay, I'm happy with that so far. I also want to be able to indicate that some of these have been washed. So they're going to have a class of watched, and this is sass, not less. So sass compiles down into CSS. Yeah, it gives us this nesting, it gives us this, which is just awesome and wonderful. It gives us all kinds of things. So now if I have an li of class watched, it should have green text. I'm actually just going to test that out. class to some of my views, and those are the views that have been watched. Right. So I'm going to just do a quick if statement. If model dot get watched, I'm going to add the class. There we go. Remember we set this as watched earlier on the curl, with curl? So far, so good. This is doing exactly what we want. Next, if you remember, we have an image in here. So I'm going to append an image to each of these list items, and its source is going to be no. This is a JavaScript object. Yeah, it's an object literal there. And then I just want to do not this view element. And then, before I do that, give it a little bit of style to introduce. Actually, I'm going to give it when I want to set something to an absolute position, I have to set its parent element to a relative position for that to work. That should do what we want, or not. Okay, well, I'm confused. I'm not getting any errors. I'm going to go ahead and just skip this image part for now because I want to demonstrate how to indicate that you've watched it and save. So in our screencast view, we have... No, this is creating a new image and then assigning its attributes. So screencast, another big part of Backbone is events. Backbone gives you some great conventions for building events. And for any view, we can create an events object. So this event is when someone clicks it, and then we can pass in a function like toggle watched. So this is when we click on one of these videos, we want it to toggle its watched state. And I'm going to define that method. Before we do any saving to the database, I just want to show that this how this works. So I'm going to just have it toggle this class. So whenever you click one, it's going to just toggle its class. And that just basically tells it to change colors. It's not saving it into the database. If we refresh, we don't have any refresh or anything. So in order to save this, first I want to check what the current value of this object is. So if it's true, I want to set it to false, and if it's false, I want to set it to true. And then I want to save. Save is what actually creates the AJAX request to the server and updates the database's attributes. So now when I click on them, they should persist. What? Yeah, back on save should do a put request back to our server like we showed before. Here, look. Writing error. So we specified the URL for our collection of data, but we never specified what the URL is going to be for each individual backboard model if we want to update them one at a time. And so what we do that in the model definition itself, and we just do a, we just add a function on this object that says return . So the URL is going to be videos plus the ID of this model in .json. There we go. Now it's saving to the database. And that's all the functionality that we talked about at the beginning. This will persist. Now, if you put this up on a public-facing site, someone could just come and change your things. You might want to put a password or something like that. No, these are all available at peakcode.com. No. I just scraped the name, the link, the image. What I wanted. I'm going to clean this up a little bit. We really don't want all of this in this callback function. That's just it kind of is destroying our object-oriented design here. And what Backbone does, there's a convention in the Backbone world for creating a collection view. I'm almost done. Which manages the collection of things of views. So what was the name of our thing? Screencast was our element. it for how we're using Backbone so far. One other thing that we're using Backbone for is observing events. There's a pattern called the observer pattern that Backbone uses a lot, that a lot of other mobile frameworks like iOS use.